Fellow caregivers, testing has been an essential part of our recovery from COVID-19 pandemic. Today, I will take you on a visit to our Pathology and Laboratory Medicine Institute to observe the testing process. We will see how our lab caregivers do this important work and why tests are such a precious resource. Let's take a look. Well, I'm joined here today with Dr. Brian Rubin. Brian, you and I had so many conversations at the beginning of pandemic about the testing. Could you please share with us what were the challenges to develop testing in the first place and then to ramp it up over the past several months?
Well, I think the biggest challenge has been time. Time has been our enemy during the entire pandemic. And so we had to launch an entirely new test very quickly. And we took on that challenge and we actually did that in about 10 days. And that required mobilizing quite a few people, getting instrumentation in line, developing the assay, validating, and then officially launching it.
How were you able to move so quickly? Because we're one of the first academic medical centers in the United States to bring testing to our patients. What was the secret of our success?
So we were able to take our expertise. We were able to take some people off of the main microbiology lines and dedicate them to developing the test. And that was really our strength, is having this very, very strong scientific community here within the Cleveland Clinic and being able to mount a test that no one else could do as quickly.
So bring us now to this stage. How many tests can we do? Where did we start and how many tests can we do today?
We started at 500. We then jumped to about 1,500, and now we're at approximately 2,500 tests per day. I will say we've done 250,000 total tests now as of just earlier this week. So that was a major landmark, a major milestone for us that we achieved.
With all the advances that we made, we've been able to create a lot of capacity. Yet the capacity for testing is still finite. So how do we use these resources responsibly, judiciously?
When we have finite resources, we have to prioritize how we use them. We start with the sickest patients. Those would be the patients in the ICU who have a respiratory illness. We want to know whether they have COVID or not. And then from there, looking at high-risk patients, so patients who are immunocompromised, those who might be sick or elderly patients, very young patients. And then as we've rolled out capacity, we've been able to open up testing to other groups. Most recently, we now are able to test patients who have a respiratory illness but are average risk.
Can you speak a little bit about the actual process of testing? What happens when we come for COVID testing?
Well, it all starts with a swab. So as most people probably know, the swab looks like a Q-tip. We basically access the virus by sticking that Q-tip in the nose where the virus lives. Then that swab comes out and it's covered essentially with mucus and virus, and then it's going to move to the lab. Now, to explain the last couple steps, you're going to go visit the laboratory and talk to a couple of my colleagues who will explain that process in detail.
So we're now in the pre-analytics area of our laboratory, and I'm joined here by Dina Allen.
Yes.
Dina, could you tell us a little bit more about what happens here every day? What are the processes when it comes to testing that are being conducted in the pre-analytics?
The couriers will pick up at our collection sites across the enterprise and they'll bring them in the back door here and drop them at the counter. Then our techs here in this building will accession those in and they will triage them. Whether they're here for stat or expedited testing, they'll stay on this floor. If they are for routine COVID testing, they'll go upstairs to molecular micro.
So how many tests do you handle daily?
For COVID, we could handle 2,000, 2,500. We've had as much as almost 2,800 a day.
But COVID testing is not the only type of testing that takes place here.
No, it's not. We're back to almost our regular volumes with our other tests. So these folks are accessioning everything that comes through these back doors.
So how many caregivers participate in this process?
On each shift, we could have as many as 20, 25 people over here, 90 overall we have on our staff.
So when the COVID pandemic started, how did you need to adapt to the new requirements of new testing?
That is the one thing about this team. They have been phenomenal with adjusting to change. We have change every day, sometimes multiple times in a shift. So they've been very adaptable to that. We have utilized staff from some of our other areas. We've brought them over, we've quickly trained them, and they're over here to help out with the COVID volume.
And with all of that, with an experience that you've now accumulated over the past several months, what are the learnings from the process?
Communication between us and the testing departments has really improved. We're really working on that piece. as well as we've different methods for triaging. We're using a color-coded system based on patient type. So we've learned a lot during this process.
The team has done a wonderful job, and not only by being able to process so many tests, but also by doing it in a way that was safe. So thank you very much for what you do.
Thank you. And this is only phase two. You'll see the next phase upstairs with Tricia and Molecular Micro.
We are now on the second floor of our laboratory. We're here in the molecular lab, and I'm joined by Tricia Johnson. Tricia, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Tricia, could you please tell us a little bit about what happens in this part of our laboratory? We just came back from a pre-analytics area where the samples are being collected, but what happens here?
So we, at the clinic, we're able to do two different pathways of testing. There is a manual method, which is completely reliant on teamwork, and then we have automated pathways. Going from the manual method, so we extract the genetic material from the swabs. Going from the extractors, we have to combine it with our master mix. We have like a sterile clean room where all our master mix is done. It has probes and primers, everything to make our reactions work to test for the COVID. So we have our master mix, which is our recipe for COVID, plus our pure extracts from the patients. We combine that together, and that's our assembly portion. So when we assemble with those two parts, we're able to put it onto a plate. We go onto the PCR room. PCR is basically a genetic microphone. It's gonna amplify whatever's in your body and letting us know, hey, there's a presence of a virus. And then after an hour or so, we'll be able to get our results.
So you spoke a lot about the manual process, which is very labor intensive, requires people with a specialized background so that they can actually do it. But we also do have parts of that process that are highly automated, and we have some new technology that we've acquired recently. Can you speak about the automated system?
Oh yeah, so the automation system that we have for COVID testing is basically the game changer in this whole pandemic. Whereas we have a team of people doing the extractors, doing the assembly, doing the analysis of the manual methods that we have, one or two people can basically do hundreds of samples by operating an instrument. In the perfect world, we want to have an entire automation line, but offering all these different platforms and methods to do testing, we're able to stay on top of the game and just stay ahead of the whole situation.
And you have been staying ahead of the whole situation.
Yeah,
thank you.
We're doing our best.
Hard work. So we cannot thank you enough. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Brian, I really enjoyed meeting the members of your team and learning more about an extraordinary work that they're doing on behalf of the Cleveland Clinic for our patients. But as we're wrapping up, could you please inform us a little bit about the upcoming flu season and how we're preparing for the flu season?
We've been preparing for flu season now for about 2 to 3 months, and we're rolling out a strategy where we can simultaneously detect flu A and B, respiratory syncytial virus, and COVID all in the same test. We think that's going to be necessary because we want to know during that season what disease a patient has. Those are the four major respiratory pathogens that we're expecting to see. So we have one test, one swab, and it'll test for all of those at the same time.
Brian, thank you very much, and thank you and your team for everything that you have done and continues to do for us every single day.
Thanks so much.
Much appreciated. Thank you. As we approach cold and flu season, the need for COVID-19 testing will be even greater. Our team is working hard to increase the amount of tests we can perform on a daily basis. I am proud of how hard all of you are working to serve our patients and communities during this challenging time. Thank you for your dedication.